ジョーンとは1年半ぐらい前に日本の ITS 国際会議でお会いして、まあ、ずっとどうしてるのかなって思ってたんですけども、というのは日本も、まあ、いよいよ、国も少し本気になって、この領域の技術をしっかりと実現に向けていこうと。で、東京オリンピックがあるので、まあ、ここをなんとか一里塚として東京オリンピックを一つの、当面のターゲットにして自動運転の実証実験をやっていこうということに、まあ、今政府が予算をつけるようになってきましたので、しかし現実的には難しい課題がたくさんあって、いろんなことを今ジョン・キャップさんにお伺いしたいんですけども、まず今レベル1、2、3いろいろありますけど、今レベル2のちょっと手前ぐらいの段階にいるのかなというふうに理解してますけども、いかがでしょうか。見てる方はレベル2の意味が分かってると思います。
Yeah, there's still a lot of work going on to try to define, you know, what are these different automated levels. The way I look at it, I mean, it, fundamentally, there's kind of two levels of automated driving. Right? There's levels of automated driving where the driver is still the one who's supervising and has a role and has to oversee what's going on. And then there's levels of automated driving where the driver, you know, might be able to actually not have an oversight role, right? And not have to do anything. And in between, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know, whatever. But I think fundamentally we have today systems that help the driver. These are driver assist systems, active safety systems. And then tomorrow we're going to have, you know, the automated systems that maybe a driver doesn't have a role in it anymore. But that's going to take a while to get there. So depending on how you view these definitions, because there's a lot of work going on globally to define them and they vary a lot, you know, that might be level 3 or 4 or 5, where maybe the driver wouldn't have a role in some driving instances, and then it would get, you know, more complex driving instances. But the fundamental difference is whether the driver has a role or the driver does not have a role. So I agree with you that as these level 2 systems, I think most people agree a driver still has a role. You're getting a lot of driver assistance, but the driver still is the one who has to pay attention because the technology isn't yet to the point where it can handle anything that can happen. So I agree with you. Most people would call that level 2, and most of the technologies that you see companies talking about today are probably in that level 2 range. And then we're starting to work on, all right, what is it going to take? How good does the technology really need to be so that a driver may not have a role, even if it's for a short period of time?
メアリー・バーラさんが GM の CEO が2017年にスーパークルーズ、これはまあレベル完全なレベル2だと思うんですけども、その時になったらドライバーはハンドルから手を離してハンズオフしてセカンドタスク、例えばまあ E メールチェックしたりスマートフォンやったりラッパ吹いたり、まあそういうところまでスーパークルーズは来るんでしょうか。
Yeah, the announcement we made at the ITS conference here in Detroit that Mary Barra said, we're going to actually put this Super Cruise concept into a real car. We said, yeah, 2017 model year. So that's, you know, really by the end of 2016. So, you know, less than 2 years.
Yeah.
That system's going to let you take your hands off the wheel while you have it engaged on certain roads, you know, limited access, freeways and highways.
Hands off.
You can take hands off the road. But you still have to pay attention, okay? So we're designing this system to understand the level of involvement that the driver still has, because today, and even in 2 years, the technology is not good enough for a driver to take hands off the road and their eyes off the road. The technology is not good enough. So this system's gonna let you take your hands off the road, but you still need to pay attention, because you may encounter some driving situations that the technology isn't ready to handle, right? So most people would probably call that a level 2 system. Again, these definitions are kind of blurry, and I don't, in my mind, what's important is, what are we going to tell the customer that this system can do, and how are we going to design the system to work with the customer? So we're going to design this system that on certain freeways, limited access highways, and we're going to use a map so that we know we're on a freeway and that we're not in a downtown city area where there's pedestrians walking. So certain areas, we'll use a map to determine that. We need to be able to see the lane markings. Our camera needs to be able to see the lane markings. And the driver needs to be attentive. And if any of those things don't exist, then we're going to have to tell the driver that you can't use that feature right now, right? We'll wait for the conditions to change. So that it's very much a system where the driver still has oversight, still has a role. So it's not a fully autonomous kind of a system, and we don't think that the technology in a couple of years, you know, is going to be ready to make those kind of claims. But we think this is a big step in moving in that direction.
その場合、まあ、オートノーマスで走ってて、システムがドライバーに戻すとき、まあ、何秒ぐらいで戻せばいいのか、ドライバー急には対応できないですよね。ですからそこは、まあ、トランジションタイムってよく言ってますけども。
Yeah, so this is an important aspect, this transition of all these systems that are going to be really appearing in the marketplace for the next several years. Because we talk about fully autonomous systems, but realistically, it's a ways off in the future before the technology is going to be good enough to be, you know, take a nap, sit in the back seat, autonomous. So the key on all these systems in between is to be able to recognize if the system is capable of functioning like we want it to, and if it's not, to make sure that the driver knows that and that communication is done in enough time. So for example, if I'm driving my Super Cruise, I'm on a freeway, and all of a sudden the system starts to encounter, maybe the freeway is ending, maybe I'm getting off the freeway, maybe the lane markings are disappearing, but you're encountering some type of situation where it can't work anymore. You know, we plan to communicate with the driver in time for them to continue just very smoothly transitioning into normal driving, you know, put their hands back on the wheel, re-engage the system. And some of the work that we're still doing, because we said we're going to launch this in less than 2 years from now, some of the work we're still doing is to figure out exactly, you know, how do those transitions best happen. It's fairly easy because every company has done it today, right? It's fairly easy to do a demonstration for a few kilometers on a car with the hands off the wheel. It's much more complicated to turn it into a real product like we have here on the showroom floor, where, you know, it's integrated in with the vehicle, it functions the way the customer wants it to, it will work when it's supposed to work and it won't work when it's not supposed to work, and that those transitions are smooth. So that's the kind of development that we're working right now. We're doing some human factor studies. We're doing a lot of testing on it to make sure that we understand all the different types of driving situations that a driver might encounter, and that it will work, you know, the way they want it to work. So, you know, we don't have it totally yet worked out how quickly those transitions need to be or what are the boundaries of them. But that's where we're doing development work right now.
Okay.ミシガンで実証実験やってると思うんですけども、これを最近いろいろといろんな条件で走りながら、何かこう新しい発見とか新しいそのブレイクスルー技術、まあ、システム、そういったところは何かこうありますでしょうか。
Well, you know, the algorithms to help us, you know, detect the lane markings and figure out, you know, where we're at, how to integrate our map data with that, how to take, you know, observation,
the interfaces,
you know, is an area where there's just a lot of development going on right now. So if we went back 2 years ago, we started to learn about some of the human behavior parts of these systems and how people might behave if you give them a system that seems like it would be more automated than it is. And we showed that, you know, you could get some misuse. People could misuse these systems and get into dangerous situations. So, you know, we've been doing a lot of work to understand what are the boundaries of those types of driving situations, and then how do we communicate with the driver in a way that they can understand, you know, what it is that the system is wanting to do. That's matured a lot in the past 2 years. Our algorithms around, you know, sensing the lanes and things like that have continued to get better. As we look to integrate things like map data into the equation, you know, those are some new findings that continue to get better. And it's going to step by step, you know, improve with each generation of vehicle. You could look at any technology that's on the floor of the show here,
And you would find that, you know, the first generation of the technology worked really well when it was introduced. And then if you look back on it, you know, you say, well, that's kind of old news. Well, but there's always a new generation, whether it's infotainment equipment, whether it's active safety, whether it's ride and suspension or high performance cars like this Corvette, each generation gets better. And we think that's the way automated systems are going to evolve. We're going to take today's active safety technologies, which continue to get better, and we're going to bring lower levels of automation to those to give the consumer more and more convenience and safety. And then we'll improve it incrementally. And that might be a different approach than there may be some technology observers who maybe want to wait and see for, you know, let's predict when the fully autonomous car is going to come out on the road. My position is level four, level five. My position is I don't know that it really matters. We need to push the technology to be all that it can be for products that are coming out next year or the year after that or the year after that. And there's really not a start and there's not a finish to this race. It's just like everything else in the car business. It continues to get more and more towards what the customer wants. And that's the key.
John の友人から同じ GM のエンジニアの人からレベル4がいつ頃か聞いとけって言われたんで、ジョンはいつ頃だとお考えですか？
If we agree to call a level 4 system, one where the driver doesn't have to do anything, right? I push a button, I sit in the back seat, and you just wake me up when I arrive at my destination. If we agree that's what we're calling, and I say that because there's still a lot of confusion and debate around these levels, but if we agree that that's what we're calling level 4, level 5, a fully autonomous car, I think that's farther out than a lot of people think. And I say that because consumers expect their cars to work really well. Other technologies and consumer devices that we buy, maybe they don't always work as expected, and consumers are sometimes okay with that. But, you know, people spend a lot of money on vehicles, and we expect them to work really well. And when we start putting these automated technologies in the vehicles, they need to work really well too. And the truth of the matter is that the technology that exists today is not perfect. And it's not going to be ready to promise a fully autonomous ride. But there are a lot of driving situations where we can give, you know, this much automation or this much automation that'll provide a lot of value. So to my point I made a few minutes ago, why wait for it to be perfect? We can incrementally provide lots of benefit along this long journey. But I think of completely autonomous cars are probably a ways off.
Level 3 だったらいつ頃でしょうか?
Again, it gets back to the definitions. If a level 3 system is one where you can be highly automated or engaged in an autonomous mode for some driving situations but not others, then you know that will happen sooner. Right? Because we know that we can even use the freeway driving situation that we're going to be introducing our Super Cruise to do. That's a less challenging from a sensing standpoint. That's a less challenging driving environment than in a crowded city center where there's pedestrians walking around and streetcars and all types of things, bicycles. So as we move into higher levels of automation, the same thing will hold true. Some of the use cases will be simpler, and we'll be able to get to the higher level automation sooner, and other more complex driving will take longer. So parking, where it's defined in a certain situation and it works under certain conditions, you know, we've had automation in vehicles already for some time. So the same thing will happen as you get into higher levels of automation. Some use cases will be simpler, and some use cases will take a long time to be to the level that we expect from cars and to be safe.
サプライヤー領域でコンチネンタル、ドイツのコンチネンタルが IBM とシスコシステムと一緒に提携して、ビッグデータを IBM がデータベースを作ってシスコがクラウドに上げる。ですから自立系センサーとインフラ協調とクラウドを使うみたいな考え方がどうやらあるようなんですけども、その辺はいかがでしょうか。
Yeah, I mean, I think it only makes sense that all these parts of the ecosystem are going to be playing a role in getting, you know, to making transportation safe, making it more automated. So connectivity is going to be a big part. So far we've talked about, you know, sensing on the vehicle and how good the sensing is, but connectivity is also going to play a role. And it gets to vehicle-to-vehicle communication, vehicle-to-infrastructure communication, input from big data. These things are all going to play a role. In the end, it's all about getting as much information as you can to help the vehicle know what's around it, to help the driver drive safely and get to where they want to go. So if I understand the surroundings really well, I can give the driver more automation. So getting data is going to help. Getting maps are going to help. Getting information from other vehicles are going to help.
最後の質問ですけど、こう段階を経て、実現に向けていく技術だと思いますけども、当面の大きなチャレンジはどの辺でしょうか、技術領域で。
That's an example of highly automated. You get on the train, it takes you where you want, it opens the door, you get off, you don't have a role. But it has limits. In general, the biggest challenge around these whole systems are sensing or perception, right? Understanding what's around the vehicle. Having the vehicle, doing the controls to steer the vehicle or guide it, we know how to do that. It all depends on how good the sensing is and how confident we are that we understand what's around the vehicle. So if I have perfect sensing, then I could go ahead and drive, you know, fully automated today. If I have limited sensing, practical reality of sensors that are available today, then I have to make all these decisions about, okay, how good can the feature be for you under these conditions? How good can the feature be for you under these conditions? So I would say the single biggest challenge is having good enough sensing so that we know exactly what's happening around the vehicle.
非常に興味深い話を伺ったと思いますけども、段階を経ていくとはいえ、かなりこの領域はアメリカでも力強く、特に GM は推し進めているように感じました。日本もこの世界の動きに遅れないように事故のない車社会を実現するために、この技術をしっかりとこの番組でもウォッチングしていきたいと思います。